Zoned!
Welcome to Phantom Zoned, the podcast where we dredge the lakes of hell in search of the worst the cinematic world has to offer and put it on trial for its various sins against humanity. Should a film be found guilty, it will be jettisoned into the far, far reaches of space, a phantom zone, if you will. I'm your host, Adrian Torres, and joining me after a long, protracted break due to him deciding that he wanted to take a rather extravagant honeymoon trip that lasted forever and caused the show to almost be destroyed, is Scott Daly. How's it going, Scott?
I'm doing good, Adrian. I'm sorry I took a honeymoon. But, you know, I was sitting there in the beautiful weather in Scandinavia and thinking, you know what I want to do right now? I want to watch a terrible movie, and I want to talk about it on a podcast. So I'm glad to be back.
You mean what you were saying is you were daydreaming of Mitch Gaylord?
It's true. It's true. We hadn't even picked this movie at the time, but somehow I knew that this was my destiny.
Yep. Well, first of all, this is our anniversary episode. This episode is going to be coming out exactly to the date on the 1 year anniversary that our first episode went up.
Wow.
It's impressive.
Yeah. I didn't know it was to the date. It's like we planned this or something, but that would be above and beyond our level of foresight.
Yes, exactly. But that's usually because we have to spend some time recovering. And you've had a long time recovering. So we're at the end, I'll mention what we're going to do, I think, for next week, if you're up for it, if you fully recuperated.
Oh, you know I'm up for it. This movie has energized me.
Okay, well, we'll see once we get done with the discussion. But I went through, well, I had a great plan for what I wanted to do for this return to form, basically for our year anniversary episode. But Scott said, I need a day to take a nap. So he wasn't going to be able to do two movies. So we are going to do that next week. So I tried to come up with a movie that I hadn't heard of that I couldn't find much information about on the internet that sounded absolutely terrible. And that film ended up being the 1986 gymnastic classic American Anthem.
A film that has a 0% on Rotten Tomatoes.
For good reason.
Film that changed the life of its star, in that I don't think he was in movies anymore after this.
No. Supposedly he was in one other movie where he was the lead, but he wasn't giving any speaking lines whatsoever. Which, after seeing this movie, totally makes sense.
Yeah.
Because he is not an actor. This movie being about gymnasts, as we'll get into.
He is an American gymnast.
This movie came out in 1986, and he won the Olympic gold medal in 1984. So they thought that he was perfect for it. They just didn't bother, you know, to ask if he could act. The same case that they had with Gymkhana, which it's kind of a through line for this movie, is you can kind of describe American Anthem if you took Perfect, that has Jamie Lee Curtis and John Travolta, if it and Gymkhana had a baby that was stripped of talent and then sat in front of a television and was only allowed to watch after school specials and Purple Rain.
That's a very complicated description, and I haven't seen all of the things that you just referenced, so I'll take your word for it. This is a crazy
movie.
Wait,
okay. Very quickly to go over it, Perfect is a movie from the early 80s that, like I said, had Jamie Lee Curtis and John Travolta, and John Travolta is doing a story about these, you know, health spas, or basically, you know, gyms where people are hooking up and stuff like that, because it was at the point of the new wave and everything, and you've got people who are doing aerobics and jazzercise and crap like that. and are in leotards and look ridiculous the whole time. And then Gymkhana, of course, is the famous terrible action film where somebody decided, you know, what if instead of taking somebody who knows martial arts, we have somebody who knows how to do gymnastic routines and we work that into a karate movie. It famously has a scene where a guy is running through what's called the Village of the Crazies, and in the middle of the town, there happens to be what looks like a stone pommel horse, which he uses to do a routine and kicks everybody in the face when they come near him.
Still haven't seen that one.
Yeah. Oh, he did too. We won't get to it on here because it's been covered too many other places. But to give the basic plot summary of American Anthem, IMDb says Steve is a talented gymnast who has given up competition and is working at his father's bike shop. Julie is the new girl at his old gym who has moved to town to train with their perfect or powerful coach. Inspired by Julie, Steve resumes training. While dealing with the conflicts in their personal lives and the stress of training, they prepare for the U.S. Olympic trials. Only about 20% of that is true.
You know, that seems to be a very common trend in these terrible movies that we watch, that the summaries of them rarely actually reference the movie that they're summarizing.
People can't remember these films after they see them, even though they're like, oh, I'm the perfect person. I should totally put up what this movie's about. But I can't remember certain elements of it. He does not work at his father's bike shop because his father does not have a job. While he does get in a relationship with Julie, he's not directly inspired by her.
No. They're kind of in a relationship in this movie, but they also, completely separate from each other, have their own arcs that don't involve each other at all.
If you can call Julie's story an arc.
Really, the only thing that their relationship does is in the middle of montages, sometimes we'll cut back to them just doing it, and then we'll cut back to them training.
Yeah, or he's completely passed out between her legs, and she has a very disgusted look on her face, it's like, what have I done?
It's like, for some reason, they filmed this scene where she wanted to get up and leave, but he's passed out on her, and then eventually she does get up, and we cut to just her looking at him disappointedly, and then leaving, and it doesn't make any sense.
So, in real life, the actor's name is Mitch Gaylord, and in the film, his first name is Steve. But then his last name is, do you want to hazard a guess how to pronounce it?
I think they pronounce it in the movie, and I think it's Tever. I think they say Tever.
Okay, we'll go with Tever then. It's T-E-V-E-R-E.
Tever? Tever? I don't know.
Tever. We'll just say Tever.
Tever sounds the most normal.
That's, you know that a movie is getting off to a fantastic start when the music sounds like it's jumping from a theme from Superman to Rocky to Flashdance. And at the same time, the images that you're seeing on the screen directly influence it. Because you start out with a black screen and it kind of sounds like a John Williams-ish, Jerry Goldsmith type score. And all of a sudden, you have a shot of mountains and very inspirational, like Rocky training music. And then a saxophone comes blaring and you've got a guy that's working on, you then realize that it's an auto shop, but at first it looks like he's working at, you know, some like backside of a steel mill or something.
Yeah. It's this is part of an extended opening montage that defines the first 5 minutes. I think if you cut out the non-montage parts of this movie, it'd be about 12 minutes long.
No. Well, I mean, it depends on what you define a montage at, because there's plenty of parts in the last third of the movie that don't have montages, but so you get at least 25 minutes from the back half.
Okay. But yeah,
that's your okay. I'll just agree.
But I think the point is that a lot of this does feel like it's just various music videos, because there's a lot of needle drops in this movie, a lot of very emotional music, and it's usually over people performing gymnastics in in shadows, in darkness, or in weird or places.
People who are using their gymnastics in their everyday working life, just like he does at the very beginning when he decides to jump up like a spider monkey to grab that one tool that's high up.
Why was there a grinder hanging from the ceiling of the shop? That didn't make any sense. Why? Who put that there?
And when he grabbed it and then he gets down, his boss looks over at him and shakes his head like, "You little scamp."
And that, like, so basically what this movie likes to do a lot is one person cuts, like insert cuts to a person reacting to something. And it does it over and over again. So this whole montage is filled with like him working on a bike, and then it cuts to his boss, like looking at him and like nodding and smiling. Like if you can imagine like 80s and 90s family sitcoms where the intro is them like doing something and then looking at the camera and then their name appears along the bottom. It's like that for a whole movie.
Well, yeah. And then at the same time, if you intercut that with shots from openings from dramas like Dallas or Dynasty, you have lots of people who start the act of walking away, then stop and dramatically turn their head back to look at the person that they're walking away from. There's lots of that too.
Yeah, it's very like any kind of film language cliche you can think of, this movie employs it. And not ironically, like not satirically, it's just like trying really hard to be this like super dramatic, important film that's not. But you know what?
It's a movie that's written by people who half remembered 175 films and then just but basically thought that all those moments that they half remembered were just moments that came to them. Like, oh, I had a dream last night that there's this guy who he's been down on his luck his entire life, and he gets a shot to go up and do something big. And then at the same time, he's got this little brother who's having a hard time, and just every single thing. And
yeah,
just like,
and he hates his dad, and his mom's the only one working. And then he was a football star, which I don't understand why that part of the story. Because honestly, when you told me this movie, you said a former football star becomes a gymnast. I was like, that's interesting. And that's kind of why I picked it, because I thought there was going to be like this goofy things about this macho football guy who like was trying to become a graceful gymnast. That's not this movie. So why he needed to be a football star, I do not understand. It doesn't matter to the film at all.
Yes, I will agree with that. So we're introduced to Mitch when he's working. Well, I'm sorry, Steve, when he's working at the shop and he's building something, and then they act like there's, you know, a race against time, and it turns out that they're making a bike for his little brother. They don't say if it's his birthday or anything. He was just making this bike for him.
No, yeah, and he spent what it seems like all day doing it. So this is his job. He spent his job making a present for his brother.
And then directly after that, he's like, oh, yeah, I need to go and climb into my old gym. Like, not walk through the front door. I have to go through the window and see what's going on. And this is where he sees for the first time the female lead of the film, Julie Lloyd. And he sees her and instantly he's smitten with her. And so he decides to come back the next day. And you see that even though he's not a gymnast at this time, he's decided that he's not going to do gymnastics at all because he's had a broken arm. But in the meantime, he's decided that he's going to continually scale the side of a building onto a rooftop, climb over to the other side of the building, take a rope down, and then walk down some pipes so that he can get into the window to enter the gym.
It's a part of him. He can't stop being a gymnast. Even when he quits being a gymnast, he's still a gymnast. He still has his weird bar in the middle of the woods that he has to go to.
So shouldn't he just be a gymnast then?
Well, no, because
does that solve the problem?
Because his dad doesn't love him, and like there's it's
whoa, you're jumping ahead.
It's a
here,
lot
Scott.
Of drama. It's okay. A lot of drama.
You're jumping ahead here, because first of all, we have to get across the fact that he smokes, you know, because that makes him a bad boy in the parlance of 1980s films. He wears his leather jacket too, you know, which means that he's a rebel. But at the same time, we learn that Julie, you know, has her own stuff going on. Like, she's got a family member in town. We're guessing that her parents don't live there because we never see them or hear about them. But she does have a cousin who lives in town who I took to calling Cassio Commander, because half the time that you saw him, he was behind his Casio keyboards.
Yep, because he is hurt. So he was a gymnast too, yes, apparently, and got in an accident, and now his...
Was he a gymnast? Did they say that? I don't remember that part.
I feel like that's why he was there. So he moved out there.
No, he to was
train.
That's where his family was.
No, because she's his family. He says that he got hurt, and then they all couldn't look at him, so he decided to stay out there instead of going home.
Yes, because that's where his family lived. That's where he grew up, and he lived there, and his family died, and he didn't leave.
Well, I didn't get that. I thought he was a gymnast, too.
Yeah, because she mentioned that they hadn't seen each other in, he says, 2 years. She says 1 year, and they haven't seen each other since the funeral that took place, because there was some car accident where they died and he lived. All this is very confusing for the entire movie, because when you first see him, he's standing up. Then when he goes to answer the door, he rides over in a wheelchair. He's in the wheelchair for half the time that he sees her. And then he's also standing up at the Casio keyboards. When he visits her later in the movie, he has a cane and he's partially dancing. And then at the very end segment of the film, at the final competition, he is standing in the hallway talking to her without a cane at all.
Yeah, well, he's getting better. It's the passage of time. He's improving.
Well, it's so whatever he's healing from.
It takes time.
Takes this long for him to be okay. I mean, if it was like a serious injury, I'd understand that. But for a while, it seems like he can't walk or stand. And then in the later part of the movies, he just has like an ace bandage around his leg.
Well, she's using his music, so he has a reason to live again. So that's why he's getting better.
He was still making music before she showed up.
Yeah, but no one was going to get to hear it. Now she's going to go to the Olympics with his music. It's very important.
I still think it'd be easy for him to send out his music from home.
I don't know. I mean, I...
Okay, good. I'm glad that that's the part that stymies you and that you're not sure about. Anyways, more importantly, we have to follow Steve. Steve has the dubious or maybe good fortune that he is the first time that I have ever seen an insult become reality. While no one tells him to do it in the film, it's still the first time that I can think of in any movie or TV show where I have seen somebody literally suck eggs. He's at home. He's rooting through the refrigerator. He grabs a couple eggs and he taps them and he sucks the yolk through them and then throws them away. I was astonished.
Yeah, that's pretty gross. But, you know. Gymnast slash football player routines. We don't know them. We're not gymnast slash football players. Was he quarterback? Because I couldn't tell.
It seemed, I think he was running back because they continually handed the ball off to him and then he was stuffed for a loss.
Yeah. But then in every like sports picture, it's like him holding the ball in a throwing position, like a throwing motion. And I'm like, what?
Maybe he wanted to win a Heisman. Maybe that's what it was. He's got a whole bunch of trophies, but the only flashbacks we see are of him sucking.
That's true. So, well, I mean, he got a 4-year scholarship, Adrian, but he turned it down for
exactly
a reason, because his dad was sad.
I get it. We won't go into that because that's, I mean, we'll get to that but it's just like, even from the way it begins, things are just confusing. Because so he goes to the gym several times to see everything that's going on. He's interested in this girl. Then it cuts to a giant party that's out in the middle of nowhere that's surrounded by a truck that says candy on it.
It's a candy party. Gymnasts, so, they can't drink because they're professional athletes, so they just have to eat candy.
They drink in the next scene, though, because then they're at the bonfire, and that's where people are drinking, and they throw the beer cans onto the fire. But when he's at the candy party, he goes and says hello to Julie for 2 seconds, and then she walks over to Becky and ends up asking who he is, and she's like, oh, he used to be a big deal around here. He was a football player and then was on the gymnastics team for a period of time, but thought he was above it, so he quit. And then you see him getting into his friend's Camaro in the most over-exaggerated way, where he does the jump in with his hands up, but gets in to be like, ha, I'm a gymnast.
Yeah, I mean, there's so much that's cliche about this scene. Because first, there's like this smoke over everything. It looks like a music video set. And yes. I love that not only does she ask about him, like she literally says the line, what's his deal? And it's just like, just like, oh my God.
It's sad. The whole reason, but directly before this, we see Julie basically define her entire arc, which is that she has been given music for her floor routine that she doesn't agree with. And that's because her floor routine music basically sounds like circus clown calliope music.
It's really bad.
Really old timey. Like if it was 1919, people might be okay with the music. The really weird thing is that everyone else in the film is using more modern music, but they never question or comment on the fact that her music is worse than everyone else.
Yeah, and it's so strange because like this is her arc. Her arc is, yeah, I am unconfident because I have my music, so I'm going to get better music, but my coach doesn't want me to get better music. But she doesn't learn anything.
No.
Because, no. Like, I thought they were going to be like, they seem to be setting up this thing where like he's like, no, I'm your coach, I know better than you, because that's what coaches do. And therefore my choice is better and it will help you become a better gymnast. But it really is just like, no coach, you were wrong. I should have done this the whole time. I'm right.
And the coach is totally for it. He's like, oh yeah, you taught me.
Yeah.
I know. Well, the coach who we should mention is played by, Michael Pataki, who is best known as Ivan Drago's trainer in Rocky IV. So once again, they're drawing from other movies, and they're like,
yep.
Oh, we're going to have him be the mean, hardened coach, but we've never seen this Rocky movie you're talking about. he has – well, I guess I'll save that for my ray of sunshine, because it's a delightful little scene that makes no sense even further than everything else. So we get to see Steve's home life, where his dad at the beginning of the movie in the montage, we see him standing at the abandoned building where I guess it was a factory gig where he used to work and has been out of a job for a year. So apparently he lost his job at the same time that cousin Arthur lost his parents. So maybe there's a good reason why these people are being intrinsically drawn together.
Maybe he crashed his car into the factory, and that's why it shut down.
If only. It does look like there was a giant fire inside the factory.
It really does, yeah.
Everybody hangs out there, by the way, too. Steve goes there all the time to contemplate. But when we see Steve's dad for the first time, he is struggling very, very – I don't even know what's going on. He's sitting at a computer and he's trying to punch in something, and he gets a series of different messages that are telling him that it's not possible. Like the second one that he get, it says input, and he hits a couple buttons, and then it pops up as syntax error and the computer shuts down on him. And when he tried to enter the first time, it told him information not found. So I don't know what he's trying to do on the computer. I don't know if he's just trying to boot it up. I don't know if he's trying to play like Frogger or, you know, what's the text-based one?
I don't know. My interpretation of the scene is that he's a man out of time. This is part of the reason why he can't get a job is because he's doesn't know how to work these newfangled computer. I don't know. That's the only reason the scene makes sense because it's never referenced again. Yeah.
Well, they don't reference the fact that directly after he's having trouble on the computer, it cuts to Mitch in the kitchen looking. Sorry, Steve in the kitchen digging around everything, and you hear what. Apparently is the dad throwing like glass bottles in the background.
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you catch that?
Yeah, I guess.
Nobody comments on it. Like, okay. The cliche character that this dad is, he's in a wife beater the whole time that's tucked in. He's laying around the house. He's sleeping at weird times. Ostensibly he should be an alcoholic, but there's never a point that you see him drink. And you never see him act drunk.
Yeah. Yeah. Question. Why doesn't he work for the motorcycle shop?
I don't know.
why did his friend help him get a son job and charge him rent?
Yeah. Oh, the rent thing just comes out of nowhere, too, when he starts demanding, when he asks him, when he's like, why haven't you been working? I need my rent. It's like, okay, so you have spent the last year unemployed. You're not trying to get a job. You have an agreement with your son where he's able to live in the house, but he has to pay rent. Meanwhile, your wife is working some job all day long and then is apparently spending half her evening out in the shed. The mom's constantly like in flux of abandoning the family too.
Yeah, I mean, wouldn't you? This family sucks.
Well, yeah, but when Steve shows up at the beginning of the scene, the mom literally goes, "That's it. You're making dinners for him. I'm not doing it anymore."
Yeah, well, and there's so much of this that doesn't make a lot of sense because, like, his relationship with his father is so weird. Because you're right, they're trying to establish this very cliche, like, daddy doesn't love me problem thing. But they don't know how to do it because it's very clear that his father broke his arm at one point.
Yeah.
So he's like literally just abusing his son. Like that's, I mean, like there's no, like he's just beating up his kid at any moment. And then they try to do this redemption angle later in the movie and it doesn't work.
Because it doesn't work because on like the second date that Julian and Steve have, which their relationship is fucked up from like the get go. So he says hi to her at the party, then shows up to the gym the next day and says, "Hey, you want to go for a ride?" And then they have a montage that you don't hear 90% of because music is playing so loud, even though you can see their lips moving. And then they're magically together. And like the second or third time that they're together, he takes her to the abandoned factory where his dad used to live while she's supposed to be on the way to gymnastics because she's dressed in her gymnast garb. And he's telling her, you know, just about all the problems that he's had and everything. And he says this that made me kind of scratch my head. First of all, she says, if you're having a problem, Steve, you should just leave. And his response is, I can't. I still kind of like the guy. Well, A, he's abusing you. So, you know, the situation where you think he's kind of okay isn't really the safest situation to be in. But then he backs it up by saying, that he got a 4-year scholarship his junior year, and then he decided to throw it away. Just throw it away. He says, "My last year of high school was a joke. My father had just lost his job. It really screwed me up."
Yeah, probably because he was beating you, the shit out of you. Like,
well, no, but they present it like the dad lost his job. And the son's like, oh, no, my daddy, he has no job. I'm going to throw away the opportunity that I could go to school completely free for 4 years and then possibly make it into the NFL and make money so that my dad doesn't have to get a job again. But no, daddy.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't make any sense. You're absolutely right. But
no, it's just... And whenever they fight, they don't really have, like, a fight. Like, it's more like really poor wrestling.
Yeah, and the problem, I mean, the central problem with this, and I think you're right, that they built a character that's clearly an alcoholic, yeah, but did not make him an alcoholic. And the reason why the alcoholic character works in these cliches, because it's very easy to telegraph change in an alcoholic by showing him, like, throw away the alcohol, but his dad doesn't really change in this movie. And considering how terrible he is to him, that damages everything, because, like, the whole time, like, Steve is just, like, wanting his father's support and wanting him to be there. And his dad shows up at the end, but he's still an unemployed, presumably drunk asshole who beats his son and probably his other son, too. So...
His poor other son. He's just there. There's so many fights that happen in the movie, and the son's just sitting there at the table, just like, I totally have no idea how to react to this.
I just want to get in my ATV and I want to drive away, preferably off some sort of cliff.
That's the insane thing about the family, is they get to a point where the mom's constantly on the verge, and the mom can't make up her fucking mind with anything, because she starts out, she's mad at the dad, and then in the middle of the film she tries to repair the bond by doing, like, trying to do a reverse, or I guess a minor parent trap, where she tells Steve, oh no, your dad really does care, you know, even though he stopped coming, here's his really shitty scrapbook that he tried to make for you. And then Steve's like, oh man, well, if only he could tell it to me, you know, himself. I just want him to show up to something. And then he goes off, and the mom directly goes over to the dad, and she's like, you need to give your son a chance. He just wants to spend some time with you. That's it. You just need to talk to him a little bit. He really cares about you. And you're just like, no, you're just making up conversations between these two people to try to get them to talk it together.
Yeah.
And then the next scene we see is of the mom getting in a fight with a dad, getting into a truck, and abandoning the family, which causes the youngest son to go, well, if mommy's leaving, I'm going to kill myself. Gets on his little AT, or his little, you know, motocross bike tricycle thing, and just drives as fast as he can to the nearest cliff to try to kill himself.
But he jumps off at the last minute.
He jumps off at the last minute, and Steve's able to get there. And then who else is there? But magically, somehow, their dog is fast enough to catch up with them. Because that's who – he reaches over and he grabs his little brother. And then they pull back to have the shot of the dog right next to him. And I'm like, when the fuck did the dog get there?
He rode on the back of the motorcycle.
No, he didn't, because Steve crashes.
Yeah, because the kid almost – he's trying to stop his brother by driving in front of him, and that just causes him to wipe out on the bike.
Oh, God. So Steve somehow gets it into his head that he should try to go back and be a gymnast. He overhears that there's going to be a series of competitions that are going to take place over the next couple months that are going to lead to what they originally said, top six men and women were going to be chosen for the U.S. Olympic nationals team. What they don't mention or specify that it's three men and three girls. So the top six overall, not top six in each position by gender.
Yeah, and that's how gymnastics actually works.
Yeah, so. But I was confused because they kept on saying the top six men and women, and it's like, well, no, it's the top three men and the top three women. There's a difference there. Because anytime they were having the competitions, I'm like, I don't understand why everything's supposed to be so dramatic.
Yeah.
You just have to be in the top six. That's not very hard. You're in 10th place. You can easily move up to six. It's not that difficult. There's no suspense here. And then at the very end, they're like, oh, only three people can be chosen. I'm like, well, fuck, you should have said that earlier. I would have understood what the stakes were. I still wouldn't care about any of the stakes because maybe they did try to present that in a way that was clear earlier in the film. But we should stress that every single person in this movie, except for the dad at certain points, speaks in a very direct monotone.
Yeah, none of them are good actors. Not even the girl who plays Julie, who's an actual actress.
Yeah. Her everyone's line reading is flat, flat, flat. It doesn't matter what the scene is about. There's never a point where there's much inflection for it. The coach does a couple times, but that's because he's vaguely Russian.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think he's pretty heavily hinted to look like Bella Caroli, right? Like, that's what they're going for.
Well, I for that demeanor, Bella Caroli had the giant mustache, so there's a bit of a difference. He was like a giant bear, whereas this guy's like Tom Cruise's height. or I guess Carrie Strug's height, is that what we go with? Is that
is that spoilers?
We'll bring that up in a few minutes. But it's weird how they present Steve going back, because it seems like he has lots of natural talent. Of course, he's played by Olympic gold medalist, so it's hard for him to try to make himself look worse, but they treat him like he's a beginner. And the coach even says, he goes, what, you thought that you could just show up and it'd be easy? You must start from the beginning. It'll be a tremendous fight. And you're like, well, he's already shown that he's better than half the people in the gym. Yeah. So why aren't you training up that? You're not giving him any motivation or anything.
And that's really one of the problems in this movie, is that, like, they seem to be aware that no one knows what good gymnastics looks like, or the difference between what good gymnastics and bad gymnastics is. So they have all these very skilled professional gymnasts doing these routines, and then they'll cut to a character reaction who will be like, yeah, good. So it's like, so you know that that was a good thing, or like, ooh, that wasn't so good. So you know it was a bad thing. And that's the only way you know.
It's the same way with the competitions. It's like, you only know if they're showing one person's face who's like, oh, that's perfect. Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
He's going to do it. Or you can hear the audience applauding. And it's not until someone's done with their performance that they're like, oh, I think I nailed it. Or, oh, I didn't do very good. And you're just like, I don't understand the rules. I don't know anything. It's like they keep on making a big deal about Julie's music that she wants to play, because she wants to play music that Arthur is doing, which is very synth heavy. And they're trying to make it seem like she's going to be have points deducted from her routine that she does. I don't know a ton of gymnastics, but I do know that when it comes to the floor routine, that it doesn't matter what your music is. You do have certain things that you have to hit, that everybody has to do certain turns and stuff like that. And there has to be certain little flourishes, but anything else is of your own design. And that it's basically interpretive dance mixed with tumbling and jumping.
Yeah, I think that's correct. Yeah.
But they don't go over any of
that. No, well, they don't teach you gymnastics at all. Like, no. There's no, like, moment in this movie where they explain what good ring performance looks like, or what a good bar performance, like, that never happens.
Plus, everybody that they show in any of the competitions are, like, exceedingly good.
Right.
They never show you anybody who's bad. Like, I think the lowest score you see in the entire movie is somebody who gets like a 9.2.
Yeah. Yeah. And they're like, pissed about it.
There's a guy who gets a 9.75 and he's like, God damn it. I'm better than this. And you're like, wait, what?
I think it was Ebert's review that said that It's like if Rocky walked into the ring and punched out Apollo on the first punch, and then like you were supposed to you're supposed to sympathize with him when he's that level of skill. Yeah, it's just like it doesn't understand the basic. As much as this cribs from every kind of sports movie ever, it doesn't understand the basics of how a sports movie structure works.
It's you don't feel sympathetic for any character or any strife that they might be having. You don't care about Steve and what's going on with his family because you know that in the end, everything's probably going to be fine. And sure enough, the day that the mom goes to abandon the family and the youngest son goes to commit suicide off the ravine, they see the mom like 5 minutes later and Steve goes, where'd you go? And she goes, you know, just to drive around. Your father and I've got some things to talk about, but we'll work it out. And the son just comes over, or the youngest son comes over and goes, Mom, I missed you. And it's just like, yeah, so we got some stuff to talk about. You need to put this kid in, you know, he needs to be in maybe a group that he meets with like once a month or a shrink.
Because issues.
You left for 5 minutes and he wanted to end his life. But I got a jet. I got a gymnastics competition to go to.
Yeah. And then he asks them to come to the gymnastics competition.
He says it's the only thing that he wants. The only thing that he wants is he wants them to come. And
so guess who doesn't come?
Mom and dad decide that they're going to stay at home. Mom in the house watching on the TV and the dad out in the garage working on another bike and another car while watching it on TV.
But his brother does come with all his biker friends from the biker bike repair
from the shop that he works at for part time until he kind of quits. Like, we never get a true word, but there's an argument later on when you hear the dad say, oh, now you're not working at your job again. I want my rent money. And first of all, I was like, you just had a scene in a montage that was like a day before where he gave you the rent money. And now you're mad about the rent money again, even though he's not working as much of the job so that he can do the gymnastics.
Yeah. Well, there's that wonderful scene when his buddy at the shop gives him a rent check, a check. And he like walks into the room with his dad and then just throws the check at him and then runs out of the room.
Runs out of the room to the woods where, as Scott mentioned, there is a high bar set up. Like, he doesn't have any other equipment. Like, he doesn't have the rings because the rings are actually outside the house, I noticed, in one of the final shots.
Oh, I didn't see it through that.
You can see it through the doorway that the rings are set up there. Why he doesn't have a high bar by everything else, but he goes out into the middle of the woods where not only does he have a high bar, but he also hides his gloves under leaves, and then directly underneath the high bar, under a giant pile of leaves, is like a safety net mat.
Yeah, it's like a small little trampoline catch thing. This doesn't make any sense. Why? No. Why are you training in the middle of the woods?
In the middle of the rain.
It's completely ridiculous. Yeah, like you're on a bar you're swinging around on a bar where your grip is so important, and you're in the rain. Like, why? Who built this? Why is this here? Why aren't you in a gym? Why aren't you in a gym? It doesn't make any sense. Why is this better training?
He has a gym that he can go to. He has a gym that he knows he can sneak into in the middle of the night because he's got all the contraptions built so that he can get through that window.
But the best part about this is, if you've seen the movie Hot Rod is directly making fun of this scene because it has Andy Samberg in the middle of the woods doing like fighting, and then he suddenly jumps on a pommel horse that's made out of a tree and starts doing gymnastics on a pommel horse.
And then he flies off it and flies
and falls down,
the cliff,
a mountain. Yeah.
Which Steve does too.
Yeah. Yeah,
In the rain, but he only goes like a few feet down, but then there's so much of Hot Rod that actually lines up with this movie. Yeah. Even though his dad's not dying, they still have, you know, the continual arguments and the dad's trying to wrestle and fight with him. He's got the younger brother that he's protective of, who's weird. You even have the inexplicable scene where the dad's asleep on the couch. And the son comes to tell him the story about how he's feeling and how he's doing and how he's going to prove to him how good of a person he actually is. Thing about this, but in this movie, when it occurs, like, the dad's just asleep on the couch. Yeah. And the next scene, Steve walks outside and the mom's just sitting in the shed, not doing anything. She's just up on a ledge in the shed, sitting there, and starts talking about the dad and mentions the fact that he gets into bed every night worried sick. And I was just like, no. Dad's been falling asleep on the couch and we sighed.
Right after
you guys aren't sleeping together right now.
He's also breaking my arms. Like, what's like, you can't make him suddenly be like, actually, he really loves you. He just doesn't know how to show it. It's like, he's breaking my arm.
He's also breaking bottles. Yeah. And apparently the thing that gets the mom to run off is he's broken the good china.
And I think that's like, that's why Hot Rod decided to parody this film, because it's so ripe for parody, because like,
it's almost a parody itself.
It really is. Like, if they had just turned into it a little more, this might have been a very successful satire, but it just, because it takes itself so seriously.
And any of the conflicts that are there are like only last for a few seconds. Like when he has one of the final arguments with his dad before the big competition, he finally goes to see his girlfriend after like days and days and days of not bringing anything up to her. And within 5 seconds of talking to her, they're yelling at each other. And his defense against her is like, she's saying, well, you should just give things a try. You need to open up to people. It's not going to work out if you don't open yourself up to people. And he goes, you haven't been here for very long. You've been here for only what? 10, 11 weeks? You know nothing. And I was like, whoa, it's not like you've been here for 2 weeks. 10 or 11 weeks is starting to get up there.
Yeah, I mean, that's also, it's your girlfriend. Like, she's just trying to help you. I just like, this relationship is so weird and unnecessary. Like, it's like they had to do it because it's a movie and they wanted to have there to be a love relationship, but
Yes. And so they have the culmination of everything that happens in the movie sees them going to the World Championship Olympic Trials in Phoenix, which is just a couple hours, I guess, from where they are. And so Steve shows up, and the first person he sees is his best friend, whose name is Kirk, who we only see them interact in like 2 scenes.
Yeah, he's barely been in the movie.
Yeah. And it's not until this final competition that we actually find out that Kirk is ranked second nationally in the country. Never something that's brought up at any other point.
Yeah, well, this is what the movie's doing now. The movie almost realizes in the third act that its two main characters are really boring. So it tries to build this narrative around two of their friends that have heretofore never really been in the movie. And like, they're like trying really hard, like half the drama of this third act, which is a third of the movie, actually. Like, I told you, Adrian, I was like, okay, we're ramping up toward the climax of the movie. And I looked at the time left in the movie and it still has 35 minutes. So I was like, oh, Jesus. But that's, I mean,
all
really,
of that is an Olympic competition. Yeah. That's 30 minutes is the trials.
Yeah, yeah. So, and then suddenly there are these two characters. I don't even remember the guy's name.
Kirk.
Yeah, okay, Kirk. And then there's the other girl's friend, who we had seen before. We had seen her a few times, a little bit more than Kirk. But still, all of a sudden her knees hurt, and that was, like, were we supposed to know that? Like,
there was no other point where they'd mentioned anything with it, because Becky and Julie were friends, but they were also Becky was was threatened by Julie just because of her natural ability and everything.
But
they never mentioned anything about the knee before that final scene when everybody's showing up to the competition and she's standing in the hallway and her knee's wrapped up and the coach comes and he goes, you pushed your knee too far, didn't you? And she goes, no, I'll be fine. And you're like, that's a really crappy way of going, oh, she's going to get hurt, and that's how Julie's going to end up getting the spot.
Right. But they never explicitly say that. And the rivalry between them is so weird, too, because, like, she is like on her side most of the time.
Yeah.
But and like willing to work with her, but then like she's against her switching her music too. She's just like, no, you just have to do it. Like you just have to listen to him. So it's like they have two antagonists on this whole music plot, which seems unnecessary.
Well, which again, there's no grounds and no explanation for when she tries at one of her practices to put the new music in and the coach is watching and everything. The assistant lady is like, you know, we should probably let her change the music. And the coach goes, no, it's not about the music. That's not the thing. We're going to have her keep it. And he even says directly to her, he goes, no, you're acting childish. It's not about the music. That's not what the problem is. The problem's within you. But it's like, no, it's not. It's yeah, literally well, the yeah. music. That's
if the
all
music's
it is.
Not making her feel comfortable, then it's the music.
No, and no, it's not. You don't understand, Scott. There's more of it. She's just being childish.
If the only thing stopping her from having a good routine is the music, then as a coach, you need to change the music. But he says, I forget what the line is, but he's something like, she's a teddy bear. I need a lion.
She is a scared rabbit. And I want a lion.
Yeah, but the music is rabbit music.
No.
It's not lion music.
He never steps in and tries to, like, coach her or anything. You know, it's like, I want a lion, but I want her to, you know, naturally.
Yeah, you got to figure that out. You got to figure that out for yourself.
That's for you to do.
Yeah.
And when Steve does show up to the competition, it's pretty great and just kind of gives you an idea of the dialogue for the entire movie. Is he shows up and Kirk's standing there and they're just standing right next to each other and they're looking out at the floor and Kirk goes, too bad you quit. And Steve goes, not anymore. And then Kirk says, good to have you back. She's like, wait, what?
He's literally at the competition. Of course he didn't quit. It's very obvious he didn't quit. He's here.
and of course, because it's this type of movie, in the final like climactic moment, when the movie realizes, oh yeah, shit, we should probably have Steve do one of these actual competitions. His dad shows up so that he can pull off the triptus. Is that what they call it? Or trippus?
Yeah, I think it's triptus. I have no idea what it is. He just spins around the bar a bunch of times and then does some. The weirdest thing about this is, like, it's his dismount. So the only special part of this routine really is this impossible dismount. But, like, midway through the routine, everyone's, like, standing up and like, looking and going, like, no, he's going to do it. It's like, how can you tell what his dismount's going to be midway through his routine?
Because of there's a couple moves that he does in the middle to try to pick up speed, basically. And the only reason that they try to pick up that amount of speed is so that they can get the full rotations that they need. Because when they have the guy who's the number one male gymnast, Ling, the Asian guy, when he does it, he doesn't need that full speed because he does more of a wide rotation where he's, you know, grabbing the knees and tucking it that way. But the one that Steve ends up doing is more of a tighter rotation, so he needs that speed, and so he's getting the extra torque in there. And so that's what they're showing them see to clue them in that, oh, he's going to do it, because there's no other reason for him to build up that much. And the whole reason why he tries to do this move is when he is at the like quarterfinals meet that they have halfway through the film. He ends up trying to prove to everybody that he's better than they think and tries to do the trippus and ends up knocking out and cracking the skull open of one of the assistants.
Who gets better and is just there at the next routine like nothing happened. Yes. And is even seemingly friendly with him now.
Well, because he gets back to telling him what he needs. And because, you know, he's like, oh, you need, you know, a 9.8.
Yeah.
And so you can get third place. Because, of course, it's the top three positions that make it. And so all he needs to get is third place. And sure enough, the movie's more than content to give him third place.
Because he gets a perfect 10 on the high bar.
Perfect 10.
Perfect 10.
But still not enough to get him fully over. Yeah. Whereas Julie's been doing good for most of the competition, and she gets her music put in there, and she ends up getting a lot of tens, so she gets a 9.95, and she ends up being the first place woman because of the fact that Becky's leg craps out on her. But the whole time in the stands, Cousin Arthur is there and is cheering for literally everyone.
Yeah, everyone that's there.
They show Ling a couple times when he's doing stuff, and Arthur's like, "Oh yeah, you're gonna do
that's,
it."
I mean, that's because they need these shots of people reacting, so we as the audience know that they just did a good thing, because we can't tell.
He's also really, really excited about the 13-year-old girl that's doing good. Which
that was
the competition,
so weird.
The competition pays more attention to this little 13-year-old girl than it does the lead of the movie, Steve's character.
Yeah, it really, like, this is 30, it's 35 minutes of competition, and it almost feels like they just filmed an actual just gymnastics competition, including showing random people we've never seen before, like this little girl who we're supposed to be so happy for because she's doing so good, but we don't know who she is.
Or the number one female gymnast.
Yeah, who we've never seen before either.
Yeah. And the reason why I say gymnast is because Scott was bothered by the monotone announcer who continually decides to over-enunciate the word.
It's so annoying. It's like a person who's never said the word gymnast before. Like, you don't pronounce it that way unless you don't know what the word is and it's the first time you're ever saying it.
Yeah. And they give her, because she's, what is it, Jo Ellen Carter is the number one lady. And she's got an outfit that kind of looks like if the German flag was turned into a V. And they call her the Flash a couple times. But no one else in the movie has, like, any type of nickname?
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. But like I said, the dad does show up in the climactic moment, and he's able to pull off the perfect dismount. But the mom doesn't show up.
No, so she stayed.
You have the son who showed up with the biker gang. You have the dad who showed up in the wings. And the mom who's been trying to patch the family all together says, "Fuck it, I'm not going."
But it doesn't matter, because it's all he wanted was his dad. He doesn't really give a shit about his mom.
Yes. And so we get a couple static shots at the very end of Kirk is able to beat Ling, and so he gets the number one guy spot. And so you have Julie, who is your female lead, standing with her boyfriend's best friend, super happy. And then a shot of Steve on the third tier, just looking really confused and perturbed.
Yeah, it's like, I don't think he realized that he won and he gets to go to the Olympics now. He's just kind of confused. And that's your heroic shot. It's so funny because, like, this movie is so, like, trying to be dramatic. And for that to be the ending just feels so weird.
Yeah. And then it just says the end and goes to, like, an orange colored screen.
Yeah.
I don't. This movie, at the time, I don't know if it did well at all. I know that the soundtrack actually did better than the movie did, because the soundtrack had like a ton of people. Is all I know.
It looks like the movie made $4.8 million. Yeah,
on what? Like probably like a $13 million.
It doesn't say what the budget is. Probably. Like, I'm sure the top dollar for Gaylord over here.
Yeah. But yeah, the soundtrack had like Mr., NXS, John Parr, Georgie Moroder. And it sold a lot. Like, it was really popular. The music's terrible is the thing. It's got that wonderful 80s, early 90s staple where the majority of the songs that play are directly describing the scenes as they happen. So like the opening song, which we'll actually play at the very end of the episode, Two Hearts, literally is syncing up with what's going on the screen. And it's terrible and it's great. There isn't much of like an actual score to the film. And that's because anytime they don't put the musics or like the actual songs over the montages, they have what sounds like the beginning of a Gregorian chant song out of just thin air.
It's drama, man. It's all drama.
It's, I don't know why it happens half the time. Like, there's a scene where Julie's getting ready to perform, you know, just practicing her routine, and all of a sudden you have, oh, and you're like, I don't know. That doesn't really convey the tone of this scene.
That's a very good Gregorian chant there.
I tried, you know. I studied for, you know, 2.5 days. I had to climb up the side of this abbey and take a rope down and go down some pipes so that I could go into the side and learn. I wasn't actually there, but I was watching. And through osmosis, I was able to learn a little bit. So,
can we mention the fact that a movie entitled American Anthem does not feature the American Anthem in it at all? Ever?
See, the interesting thing about that, Scott, is I'm not familiar with an American anthem. I'm familiar with a national anthem.
Well, it's the national anthem for America, so that would be the American anthem.
Do you know what that's called, Scott?
It's called the Star Spangled Banner.
It's called semantics. All right. Do you have a ray of sunshine in this?
You go first, because I don't want to take yours accidentally.
Oh, mine? Well, I've got two. They're both very short ones. First off, this probably has my favorite use of the one F word in a PG-13 movie. And that's when Steve gets in the fight with his dad, who the dad, we should mention, everyone in the Trevor family has a name. Because Linda is the mom, Mikey is the son, Steve is the main character, and then the dad is just Mr. No name. They couldn't spend 2 seconds to be like, we'll call him James.
Nope.
So Mr. and Steve end up getting into the fight when the mom leaves, and that's when Steve decides to yell, "Why don't you just break my other arm, huh?" And is trying to pin his dad down, and then tells him, "You know, get out of here." And the brother comes walking up, trying to, you know, find out what's going on, and Steve just turns to him and goes, "Get the fuck out of here!" And that's what causes Mikey to run off and decide that he's going to kill himself because mom has driven off, and his brother told him to get the fuck out of there.
Well, there you go.
My number one favorite moment is when Steve decides that he's officially going to come back and be a part of the team. He decides to drive his boat down to the docks where the coach is untying his boat. And they have a little conversation. And then the coach decides to drive off, except for the coach is in a speedboat. He is dressed head to toe. He has no fishing gear. And he doesn't appear that he's going to be going swimming. So he just gets into the speedboat and drives off at the end of their conversation.
Yeah, he's going for a joyride in his boat.
He's not prepared to be out on the water, is what I'm saying. Like, he's dressed as if he's going to golf. Like, he has to take the speedboat across the lake to be able to go to the, you know, the golf course that he's going to play at. That's what it looks like.
I mean, that's probably what's going on. He's so confident that he's not going to sink his boat that he doesn't even need swimwear.
It's not even a case of that. It's just like he's not – he doesn't have anything else with him. Like, he didn't bring any food or anything like that. Like, he's just going out on his little speedboat by himself, not prepared for the day.
Yeah. I mean, this movie doesn't make any sense. It's funny. You're right.
It doesn't like they don't have to have that scene. Like, there's no reason why Steve can't just show up to the gym.
Yeah, they had to scout the location. They had to rent a boat.
They had to choreograph Steve very slowly going down that gangplank that leads to the dock.
My guess is the actor was literally just on his boat that day, and they needed to get the scene in, so they did it down there.
Hey, Mitch is free today, so we're going to film me down by the dock. Yeah. They had plenty of scenes where the coach was in his office not conversing with anyone else that they could have easily just, you know, shot it then. That's what I don't understand.
Yeah.
What about you?
My favorite moment is when this movie predicts the future. Because this movie was made in 1986, and our coach, who looks kind of like Bella Caroli.
They do not. Again, they do not.
He's lying!
No.
I mean, take away the mustache. He's supposed to be Bella Caroli. I'm convinced of this. But anyway. Yeah,
but just because he's based on him, he doesn't look anything like him.
You're ruining my point. What's the name of the girl who had the injured knee again? I can't remember.
Is it Carrie Strug?
No, not in real life. Yeah, it's Carrie Strug in real life, but in the movie.
Becky Cameron.
Yeah, okay, so Becky is doing a routine, and she gets hurt, and in this instance, it's the floor, but she gets hurt, and she finishes the routine triumphantly, and then her coach walks out onto the floor and picks her up and walks her away, and everyone's cheering for her, and it's this big, huge moment. This, of course, was 10 years before Carrie Strug did the same thing on the vault, and the same thing happened with her coach picking her up and walking. It's like, it was eerie, so much to the point where I was like, when did this movie come out? When did that happen? Was this, I was creeped out a little bit.
Well, and she injures it, or she's already hurt, but she hurts it further beginning at the vault.
Of
all places.
You're right.
And that's where they did have the famous, she gets picked up by the coach after the floor routine, but she still does have that stumble and then pop up to say that I'm okay that she had then. Who was the other one? I don't think that she was injured, but who was the, from the 80s, who was the gymnast?
Oh God, I don't know gymnast names at all.
She's in Scrooged. With Bill Murray? You know what I'm talking about? Because they make it a point to say her name because they mention that she does the little backflip into one of these. And then, sure enough, they show her later on in the movie. Because I'm trying to remember, because she didn't have an injury when she did it, did she?
I don't – maybe she – maybe – I don't think so.
I know that Strug definitely did, but I'm trying to remember this one, and I can't remember her name. Mary Lou Retton.
I don't think she was injured, no.
She never had an injury? Okay.
No, I don't think so. Someone let me know if I'm wrong.
Yeah, but Mary Lou Retton is also close to kind of the Becky standard, since Mary Lou Retton won her things in 1984 as well.
Yeah, it was interesting that, like, even, like, her hair wasn't exactly the same as Carrie Strug's because it was more 80s, but it was similar.
Yeah.
It freaked me out. It freaked me out a little bit.
It's crazy. I smell a conspiracy.
I just checked out. damn it. Actually, she was a knee injury. She got a knee injury.
Who?
Mary Lou Retton.
Mary Lou Retton?
Yeah.
On the floor routine?
No, with two events to go, she scored perfect tens on floor and vault. The last event in especially dramatic fashion, had there been fears that her knee injury and the subsequent surgery might impair her. So she had a knee injury, but not during performance. Yes. So it was not the same. They predicted the future. It was crazy. But it's my favorite part of the movie.
But you know who the coach of Mary Lou Retton was?
No.
Bella Caroli.
Oh, yeah.
Who has a mustache. And is twice as tall as the coach in this.
Look, he's looks kind of like him.
No.
They didn't have CG to CG on a mustache like they're doing the reverse of for Superman. So they had to just, they asked him to grow a mustache. He said no. He said, fine, people will get to your Bella Caroli.
Yeah, I got it. I understand. Let's get to the voting.
All right.
What do you vote, Scott?
You know, I enjoyed this movie more than you did, but it is not a movie I really would ever want to watch again, so I'm going to say guilty.
Yes, it's very simple. Guilty. get it out of here. Like I said, both Siskel and Ebert agreed that this movie was absolute garbage and trash. They both gave it half a star. They are fantastic reviews. There are plenty of other reviews that if you check out there that are great. Like, everybody trashed this movie. It seems mean to point out, but at the same time, it's vindication, because you sometimes get some of these movies where you'll have a lone voice who tries to be, you know, to be like, no, you guys are being too hard on these films. But these movies, or this movie in particular, it's a good reason that it has a zero. It's not a zero on Rotten Tomatoes because nobody reviewed it. It's that the top people gave it terrible, terrible reviews. Just a couple of other little tidbits out there is from the New York Times said this whole movie may have been concocted on a synthesizer. Gene Siskel's full quote was, the characters are laughable. The gymnastics are unattractive. There is nothing to recommend about this film. The Orlando Sentinel said, cast and crew are guided by the director from manipulative cliche to manipulative cliche as everyone tries his or her best to overlook the fact that Gaylord, despite his athletic prowess, has little or no show business talent.
Damn.
And it's just the funny thing about this movie is the guy who directed it, Anthony Mignoli, directed Purple Rain, and Purple Rain, for the most part, has like the same story, you know, about an up and coming musician who's got problems with his father, scenes that are out of the rain. You've got the girlfriend who's also an up-and-coming talent, and it's the execution. It comes down to talent that you have and the execution and the way that you present it. Something like Purple Rain lends itself to having lots of musical montages. It also helps that your lead actor was a musician. You can't just take that and decide, okay, this person has a background in this, that therefore the movie is going to be great. You know, you can't decide that, oh, hey, we're going to make a movie about horse racing. Give me the best jockey that's out there and we're going to have the greatest movie ever. It doesn't have
sadly,
that.
Sadly, you are correct.
Yeah. But you can do that with musicians the majority of the time because they're performing already. They understand what it is to play up to both an audience and a camera. They understand putting on a facade that may be different from who they're, you know, who they are. You don't have that in a gymnast. And the fact that anytime Mitch Gaylord ends up speaking in this movie, you kind of either want to fast forward or put it on mute speaks to that.
Yeah. Yeah, I think if you feel the need to watch this movie, just watch Hot Rod instead, because it's better in every way.
Yeah, I wholly support that. I'm probably going to do that after this.
Yeah, I kind of want to go do that too. I haven't seen that movie in a while.
Okay, so since this is our year anniversary, I thought that we would, you know, take a look back at some of the movies that we've done and try to see what's worked, what we've enjoyed, and what we want to do moving forward. So my question to you is there any movie that we decided we should send to the Phantom Zone that you believe we were wrong in doing? Or is there any movie that we decided, no, we're going to give you a stay of execution that we should have actually sent off?
Well, our first episode was The Happening, correct?
Yes.
And I believe we called that guilty. And yes. I think compared to the movies in the past year that you have made me watch, The Happening is brilliant and a masterpiece, and I should not have voted guilty on that.
I'm still going to stand with how I feel about that. I still dislike The Happening.
I don't think it's a great film, but I just think, like, if looking at this list of movies, it's way better than all these things.
I've actually been pretty happy with the way that that we were able to suss out several of these movies. I think that we've been honest, and the fact that we did have something like The Happening, which you feel we were wrong in, the fact that we were still able to vote it out, it shows that we have a good track record, because there's plenty of times like I could easily see you trying to have the staunch case and be like, no, we're not going to do it whatsoever because of how I feel about the director, regardless of any merit or how that film is based upon the director. We should save it. But we haven't had any time where that's been something that's held us back, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it does. So what out of these is your favorite movie?
Oh, God, that's difficult. I enjoy lots of elves, but I still got to go with the one that I championed from back in the day. I'm still going to side with I Am Wrath.
I did quite enjoy that movie. I think for me, it's elves. Elves is my favorite of these.
Yeah.
I loved that movie.
There's nothing wrong with that decision because it's kind of a perfect storm of elements. There is terrible acting. There's terrible writing. There's terrible camera tricks. There's story elements that don't work. There's scenes that feel like they're improv'd. There's little moments out of the corner of the frame that make no sense. Like, I still love the fact that going back and watching the scene where the professor's given the explanation about the elves, that there's a girl who, for whatever reason, decides to pick up the rib and smack the other girl on the nose with it and then put it back down on the plate. And you don't notice that. It's there. They captured it. It's there forever. So I love elves, but there's something about I Am Wrath, and I don't know if it's just because it has somebody like John Travolta in it, and to see certain actors fall on hard times and then have the magic that is Christopher Maloney acting against the logic to everything else in the film, to the fact that the movie is probably should be about 30 minutes longer, and they just decided to cut it really short. So I don't know.
Yeah.
We've watched some stinkers. I haven't been completely ultra mad at any movie, but I think we've done a good job in choosing movies that most people don't know. So if they stumble upon us somehow, I feel sorry for them the majority of the time. But we're able to educate them, and at the same time, we're getting movies that fit the basis that we want, which is still that we're not looking for a movie that to be so bad it's good. There are times that we might luck into a movie that is like that, but it's never on purpose. We're never, you know, we're not out there online looking for, what's the best so bad it's good film. We're trying to find the worst of the worst out there. And occasionally you'll stumble upon a diamond in the rough that does have those elements where it does become so bad it's good, like Elves. But Elves, like I said, it's a perfect storm.
Yeah, I agree. I definitely agree. What would you say is your favorite episode? Because I still think our Poltergeist 3 episode is my favorite. That was the most fun to listen to.
I like that one. Still missed a couple of the drops. So
I'm sorry.
I gotta give you a hard time on that. But I think I have to say, just because some people in town, some friends who've heard it mention it, and then, of course, the people that we did it with bring it up time and time again, is the Ghoulies 3 episode.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. We need to have them back.
Definitely. Oh, I know they'd be up for it, because I talk to them. I mean, I see them at least once a week, but a couple months back, there was a point where Genius made the comment that he was like, we're always so positive about movies that it was fun to see that we could do the opposite, and that we could openly be negative about a movie when the time calls for it. And we'll still kind of mention it to each other to get on each other's nerves by mentioning, this movie wasn't as bad as Ghoulies 3. So it's it's become a kind of mark of pride. And it's great that there's still moments on there that you can listen into that episode and you can hear all of us just kind of sigh and then just go, fuck this movie. okay, you said Poltergeist 3 is that's your lock for your favorite one?
Yeah.
Okay. Which episode do you like the least?
Oh boy, I'm not prepared for that question. Okay. I think...
Because I thought I knew what answer you were going to have, not necessarily because of how we did, but how the movie made you feel.
I mean, the only movie that made me, like, super mad, it was Cinderella to Justice, so...
Yeah.
That's probably my least favorite episode, just because I hate that movie so much.
I think I would have to choose that same one because of the fact that you didn't like the movie so much that you didn't really want to do the episode.
Yeah, like there was so little to talk about. It's just like, this is shit. Like, what else can I say?
You have to find ways to make it entertaining. moving forward, is there anything that you want us to, is there any grounds that you think we should cover that we haven't yet? Is there anything that we should do to spice things up? What do you think the people want?
I don't know. I think we should keep going. I like when you first told me the idea of picking really obscure movies that no one has ever heard of, I wasn't sure about that because I didn't know, like, are people going to want to listen about a movie they'd never heard of? But I think it's worked out. I think it's fun. It's been an education for me because a lot of these things I just never heard of at all before.
Oh, man, the research that I do when I'm trying to whittle down some of these movies, like the rabbit hole, there's movies that I don't want to cover on here. Just because either A, getting a hold of them is really expensive. And what people don't realize about the change, and when technology changes so fast, there's so many movies that get left in the dust. And as many movies as we have on Blu-ray, there's still tons that haven't made the transition from DVD to Blu-ray. And then you go back even further to VHS tapes, and you have movies that have never made it from VHS to DVDs. So you've got some movies out there that have various reputations that you can only find if you buy the VHS tape. And you can look out there on Amazon and you'll see some VHS tapes, some movies that start at $65, that start at $95, that start at $273. So there's some that we won't be able to cover unless one of us wins the lottery, because we're not going to be willing to spend that money and our wives will probably kill us.
Yeah, I think that's a safe assumption.
There is one that I want to cover in the next month that we will have to go the route of watching it on YouTube. And that's because it has a very cool story. So I will let you guys know about three sets that we have upcoming. One of them sometime in the next month is a movie that's called Inchon. I believe that's how I'm pronouncing it correct. It's Inchon. It is the worst war movie ever made. And when I say that, I don't necessarily mean from a critical standpoint. I mean from a financial standpoint. It's a movie that cost $46.7 million just the film itself. That doesn't include the marketing or anything else that went on to it. It made around the entire world $5.2 million. It's a movie that did so bad in theaters that it has never been released on VHS, DVD, Blu-ray, or digital. The only time that the movie's been shown is either in theaters or then on a couple special television broadcasts on ABC. So the only way that you can find it is there's a person who put it up in 14 different clips on YouTube because they had an old VHS tape and they loaded that VHS tape up to YouTube. But it stars Laurence Olivier as General MacArthur, and deals with MacArthur having a connection with God during the, I believe it's the Vietnam War, I want to say, or World War II. Which one? World War II was MacArthur, right? Yes. But it deals with him having a connection with God and dealing with North Korea, and was fully or mostly financed by a super crazy unification church. A super crazy church that had specially made VHS tapes made of the movie when it wasn't going to be officially released on that format that people were told to worship and watch at least once a week. It also turns out that Laurence Olivier decided to go one step further than Michael Caine, and when he was asked why he did the movie, he said, "The money, dear boy. I'm getting at the age where all that matters is what you leave behind, and all I can leave behind for my family is the money I make from these last couple of films."
Huh. Wow. That's kind of crazy.
It's a movie that sounds up our alley.
Yeah.
We're also going to be covering a movie that's called Under the Rainbow, which stars Carrie Fisher and Chevy Chase, and deals with people staying at the hotel at the time that the auditions were going on for the Munchkins for The Wizard of Oz. And it does star several little people, one of which was the very famous Billy Barty, who most people would know as Gwildor from He-Man, Masters of the Universe, or they would know him as the elder wizard in Willow, who tells everybody to, you know, follow the sparrow. And he won a Razzie Award for his performance in it. But you got little people, you got Chevy Chase.
Oh boy.
In a period film. Yeah. The one that I'm most excited about that was originally going to be this episode, but we are going to push back to next week. This is probably going to be the biggest high profile episode we have. And what I mean by that is going to be covering movies that people know of. I'm not going to say what the movies are yet, but what I'm going to let people know of is that we are going to be covering two Neil Breen movies. And that's because I've been asked continually by people, have you thought about doing Neil Breen? Have you thought about doing Neil Breen? Have you thought about doing Neil Breen? And while he's gotten to a level where he's definitely with like the Tommy Wiseaus of the world, you got to give the people what they want. And since we didn't do it for this episode, we're going to do it for the next one. So I'm calling the episode the Breenification. So hopefully it goes well.
I certainly hope so.
Okay, Scott, where can we find you on the internet?
I can be found on Twitter at ScottDaily85. You can also see my writing, other podcasts I do, and more at DailyPlanetFilms.com.
You guys have another big one that's on the website that people can easily click on if you want to mention that to them.
Yeah, that's the We've Got Worm podcast. We're going through the web serial Worm arc by arc. We're doing pretty good. It's a lot of fun. So if you've read that book before, if you haven't, I would check it out.
There you go. You can find me on Twitter at Yo Adrian Torres. You can also find my writing at boomhowdy.com. We did not get lucky enough in Kansas City to have a screening of the Emoji movie. I'm very, very sorry. But I do have two side reviews that went up. Shudder.com just had the exclusive rights to the movie Cusco, which is a very over-the-top, gross-out film, but has a lot of skill and like technicality underneath it. It's hard to watch because it's got lots of crazy shit that's in it. But I definitely watched the next movie that the director did just because he shows a lot of proficient craft. And then two nights ago, I was really lucky to get to see a screening of the new Alejandro Jodorowsky film Endless Poetry. And that movie is a trip. If you live in a city that gets it. Right now it's out in LA, New York, and opens on the 28th, so the day this will be coming out. It opens wide to major cities, so like all over Texas, all over Illinois, a whole bunch of different cities and states are going to be getting it. I suggest it. It's going to alienate some people because it really leans into the art and art house, but it's a great film.
Awesome.
At the same time, even though you guys are listening to us in one way or another, we should mention that our actual handle, because I continually forget to let people know where you can actually get a hold of us, because we're more than happy to hear any films that you guys want us to try to cover. Of course, we got to make sure it meets the criteria, but we're more than willing to, you know, give it a look. It's at phantom_zoned, that's ZONED, on Twitter, or the Phantom Zoned Cast at gmail.com. So we look forward. At the same time, if you guys have any questions about the movies we're watching or anything you want to bug us with in general, you know, send us a line.
Yeah, we're happy. Absolutely. We'd love to hear from you.
All right. Until next time, you guys. Be good. In LA, New York, and opens on the 28th. So the day this will be coming out. It opens wide to major cities, so like all over Texas, all over Illinois, a whole bunch of different cities and states are going to be getting it. I suggest it. It's going to alienate some people because it really leans into the art and art house, but it's a great film.
Awesome.
At the same time, even though you guys are listening to us in one way or another, we should mention that, our actual handle, because I continually forget to let people know where you can actually get a hold of us, because we're more than happy to hear any films that you guys want us to try to cover. Of course, we got to make sure it meets the criteria, but we're more than willing to, you know, give it a look. It's at phantom_zoned, that's ZONED, on Twitter, or the Phantom Zoned Cast at gmail.com. So we look forward. At the same time, if you guys have any questions about the movies we're watching or anything you want to bug us with in general, you know, send us a line.
Yeah, we're happy. Absolutely. We'd love to hear from you.
All right. Until next time, you guys. Be good.